responsibilities. Skye is a young Cherokee woman. She's a daughter. She's a sister. She's a student and scholar. She's Miss Cherokee. So with each of those roles comes differing responsibilities. And so she was kind of going through all of that herself too, trying to figure out how all of that played into this research. And so a lot of it, and when we started talking, I think, and when we sat down, kind of at first was like, okay, I want to know more about this question. I would like to have help with you telling me where I can get this knowledge, and then I'll have the knowledge. And the way I said it, I said, you know, this is really going to be more about process than you really finding an answer right now. This is a question that you might have for the rest of your life and seek knowledge on for the rest of your life. So let's focus on the process of how you get there. And so that's what we attempted to do, is really look at what a respect for the process even means, what it even looks like. And then if you're talking about going about research in a good way, what's that mean? You know, and how can you embody that? So with that, I will turn it over to Ms. Wildcat here and let her finish the presentation. At the end of the presentation, what we were hoping to do is draw upon your knowledge and better understand if you've had any experiences yourself personally or in working with community, not just necessarily here in Cherokee Nation, but even beyond in other tribal nations, that might help her in the future to continue answering this question. So that the last part of this workshop or session is really going to be kind of interactive and workshop oriented. And so we hope that you all will feel comfortable in providing your thoughts and experiences, potential resources to her to further her scholarship.
First of all, I want to thank you guys for coming on a Friday afternoon, because obviously there's a lot of things that you put together. So this is the abstract. And this is something that Tiffany helped me develop, because there's a lot of big words that I don't use. And so this would be more of something that would fall into like a Western acceptance. They would probably look at this and probably justify that as research. Whereas if I were to write it in the way that I found more, I guess, fitting with certain words, they probably wouldn't see it as that. But it is, it does capture really the whole picture of what I'm trying to present. So you can go ahead and read over that. But I do utilize some of the cases like DAPL, Diamond Pipeline, and then a few others that I'm going to talk about as well. So researcher positionality, the just general definition is a consideration of its, which is the researcher's, influence and place in research. So when that also falls into the use of indigenous research paradigm when studying indigenous people, which requires the holistic use and transmission of information. So that basically means that we are the storyteller. We have a place in this research, whereas people, like Western research wants to really eliminate the bias as much as possible, but that's impossible because we chose to do this for a reason. There's a reason that we're in this field. So that's the next slide I'm going to talk about. So this is my positionality. This, you can read that yourself, is something that I did with a group on campus, the American Indian Science Engineering Society. We took the time ourselves to go and clean up a road. Just clean up the trash around it. And I mean, it wasn't that, like, the road wasn't very big, the section that we cleaned off, but there was a lot of trash there. And so that really helped me to develop that relationship with land and water, understanding it in my own way, by spending time with it, by spending time with learning how much it's affected by what we do. And then the picture on the top right is me as Miss Cherokee. And my platform as Miss Cherokee is environmental preservation. So I go across the country and that's what I talk about. I talk about how important water and land are to us, not only because we drink it and eat it every day, but because we use it for our ceremony, we use it for the daily practices that we have, or at least traditionalists do. And that's also, the picture with me is Pat Gwynn, and he's taking me on the tour of the garden they have there, which has a lot of the traditional medicines and river cane and stuff that people don't know about. And so the picture underneath that is a picture of me and a group of my friends up in Standing Rock this past November. And so obviously that's really where it started to grow, or that was the reason I went there, because I had this relationship, and we all did whenever we went there. When you go there, you see the community, you really realize why they're fighting for this. And So that made me want to come here and do something like this so that I can convey that to other people, why it's important. And then the bottom picture, it looks kind of cheesy, but we were picking wild onions. I don't know if you can see them, but I'm holding them. But that's something that I grew up doing. Going to the river, going to the forest, picking them, cooking them, cleaning them, the whole process. And it takes a lot longer than you would think, but that also helps you develop the relationship. So this is the introduction to the actual research. Oh, wait. Again, we talked about the research paradigm, broad principles that provide a framework for the research. And so then underneath that, we define it as the indigenous paradigm. So the principles that I went over that go into the framework of the research is respect for elders. That is where I began with my research. And then responsibility to maintain relationships with non-human beings to acknowledge the agency of those beings, like plants, even things you can think about, like rocks. They tell us a lot about what is going on in the earth, what's going on in the water. Whenever it's oxidized, it turns red. And so that means there's a lot of metals, there's a lot of chemicals that are being put in there that probably shouldn't be there. And why is this relevant? I'm sure you all have your own ideas of why this is, but these are some of the main factors that that really struck me that's going on around Cherokee County. And so the Sequoia Fuels Corporation, they are a factory that's in Gore, Oklahoma. So it's in Cherokee Station and not too far from here. And they manufacture nuclear rods that fuel a nuclear plant company. And so recently there was a lawsuit from the Cherokee Nation saying that they've been trying to clean up the waste from the plant that's no longer there anymore. They were trying to clean up that radioactive waste, but their plan to clean it up was to take it one place and put it another. And that place that they were gonna put it was near the Arkansas River. Obviously, that's where we drink. That's where we fish. That's where we eat from. And then the next one is the Diamond Pipeline. And that's something that's coming. It's coming through Oklahoma, Arkansas, Tennessee. It's about to be here. And so there have been protests starting in Memphis, and I'm sure there will be some in Oklahoma soon. But that would desecrate sites along the Trail of Tears, like in Indian Burial Grounds, which is a lot similar to the Dakota Access Pipeline, which is something that they did as well. They uncovered their ancestors, basically, and also went underneath their water roots. And then river pollution. The Tyson Chicken Farm Company out of Arkansas dumps their waste is run off into the Illinois River, which we swim in, we float down, we drink from, and the high levels of phosphorus, they get in there. And they hurt the fish, they hurt us, and more than we really realize. And so this brings me to the general research question. What is the Cherokee relationship to land and water? So the method that I went about, like I said earlier, I started with elders. So I started with the three Cherokee elders and a language specialist because language really ties in to that relationship, and I'll talk about that later. But if you were to define it in a Western context, it would be qualitative, meaning instead of analyzing numbers, I analyze words. So there were semi-structured interviews, and the questions that I asked to the elders were, what uses do you have for land and water, general or traditionally, and how has this changed over time and why? Have you passed on this knowledge, and how have you passed on this knowledge? And advice on approaching others regarding land and water. And this was also done by snowball sampling. Like, I started with my grandma, and I would go and talk to her. She said, oh, well, you know, this would be a good person to talk to. So that's how it went. It went throughout the community. Then people would refer me to another person because, you know, who knows more about our community and who's knowledgeable rather than our elders. And then Tiffany talked about the decolonizing methodology. And she really defined that better than I could. So these are the themes that I developed from the quotes that I'm going to show you later that define the relationship to land and water. And that is language, the underlying, assumed, embedded, and foundational aspect of worldview. So some examples of that are like Cherokee names for land, Cherokee name for water, the Cherokee name for the plants that we have around us, the animals and the nature. And the next one is land-based knowledge, which is just a general knowledge of what the land provides and how to use it. Gathering foods like wild onions, watercress, all that, G-Sun. And then medicines, and when to gather, like seasonally, and how to gather. What's the proper way to gather? Do you gather all of it at one time, or do you take it piece by piece so you have something the next year? And then the last part is ceremony. Practicing or knowing ceremonial practices regarding water and land, and like a going to water ceremony, and how the medicine that you gathered is used for that ceremony. And that was a difficult one for me because I grew up culturally, but I didn't grow up with ceremony. And so really to listen to what people were telling me, I didn't know how to convey that in the correct way. I didn't know if I could talk about it the way that they told me. So let's start with the language and worldview. And again, the definitions at the top. And so these are just some of the quotes that I took from what people were saying into, that's how I developed themes. So attending, caretaking, and sustainability aren't necessarily terms expressed in charity because it's considered something people are already doing. A lot of nature, plants, springs, and things of that nature are classified as living entities in a grammatical way. Living right or living Cherokee, white path, part of social relations are relationships with one's surroundings and with the environment and taking care of those, just like you would do with family. So really, whenever I talk to Wyman about the relationship to the land and how you define that in the Cherokee language, there wasn't necessarily a word. It wasn't like Gaduki where it just means a community coming together. It wasn't defined because it was there. It's in the way we act, it's in the way we speak, it's understood. And so the next part, land, it gave me the Cherokee word for that, Gado, basically meaning the ground. Cherokee doesn't have a good way of talking about land in terms of ownership. We don't own the land necessarily, it owns us. Going into the woods and gathering this medicine requires the words. When you practice this kind of culture, you ask the creator in your language about what you're going to use this medicine for. When I was talking about the water, the song, which is one of the ceremonies that he was talking about, it's Cherokee. You cannot do it in English. So to do this in the proper way requires the Cherokee language. If you're really going to develop the relationship and asking for medicine and going out to gather it, you should know how to do it in Cherokee. And then next, I'll go into land-based knowledge. Resources such as streams are seen as being communal property. Therefore, everyone's responsibility to ensure that resource continues. So whenever he said that, he was talking about a stream. People who owned part of land that had a stream behind it, and instead of closing it off, like a lot of people do, they opened it. They opened it to the community because they understood that the water can be owned. It's everybody's property, and it's their responsibility to respect it and maintain it. And the first thing non-traditional people will do is buy land and clear-cut the area and fence it so that no one can go in. And that is where most of our medicine, wild onions, and mushrooms grow. We must have that. And again, that goes into the sense that if we continue to like enclose the land that we have because we think that we own it, then that really shuts us off from following the traditional ways, going out and gathering the medicine, wild onions, and mushrooms that we need to. And then we have the right as Indian people to go gather, but we can't enforce that. And when he said that, that really struck me because I know how to gather wild onions and a few other things, but I don't know what the medicine looks like. I don't know how to go out and gather that or even what seasons to go out and gather that. So people, we have a lot of elders that can teach you what you need to do. That doesn't necessarily mean you're going to do it. We have to have clear streams and go back to the nature, not only as human beings. We have to think about the four-legged creatures and the birds in the sky. They have to have water and food too. That's one of the things we don't really talk about. In our group, which is the other group that John was talking about, that's what we talk about. If we lose all that, we lost the wildlife too. So it's not only about us. It's not about us just to maintain the streams and the food. It's about the wildlife, and that's also our food. We have to think about other things outside of our own broad spectrum. And when you gather medicine, you leave something like tobacco and ask the creator to gather this medicine. You don't gather all of the medicines you see. You've got to leave some so that the next year you'll have more. And this goes back to what I said earlier. Traditionally, you would leave something. If you're going to take something from the earth, you need to give something back. And that's the way that it works. Now we only have a handful of knowledge from what we see around us. All the plants, even the grass, could be used as medicine at one time. And to really think about that, that's how much have we lost? How much has changed over time, and why has it changed? That's another question for a different part of my research, but maybe that'll be there. And the last part, ceremony. And when she's talking about he, in the first quote, she's talking about her dad. So he did it to make sure I was protected. I wouldn't be there long. When he gathered us, he would make us all of us go, and that was protection from now until we meet again. So she was talking about a going to water ceremony that she did as a kid. Her dad would make her go when she was on breaks from school. She would make all their family members go. And when I first started talking to her about it, she didn't enjoy it. She was young and she didn't really understand it. But when we started talking more about it, she explained to me the protection process that it really involves. And then the next part, medicine man would use water with songs for things like a headache. They twirl the water around and drink it and blow it on your head in the four directions, four times a day. And I kind of heard stuff about that, and maybe you have too. But that, again, is another part of ceremony that's just so simple. It doesn't necessarily involve getting up early or a certain time of the day or whatever. It's something that they just knew to do. And the way John talked about it, it worked. And I guess he's had experience with that as well. On the new moon, they would go to water and go 4 days straight in the afternoon and evening. That would purify the body, rejuvenating yourself, and that would go on the next month, and you would start over and clean yourself. Again, that's a cleansing process that water brings us. That's another ceremony that they would practice just to stay clean and pure for the next year. So now I'm going to talk about the changes over time that was really noticed. And some of the things that will come out of here are obvious, like time and access. But you can read those quotes yourself because the things that come with it. You guys know that you could just go to Walmart and get wild onions or mushrooms for a certain price and for less time than it would take just to go out and get them yourselves. And that's the biggest part, I think, was when they were talking about it, is that we don't, when she was talking about the poke salad, it's just like spinach. She can open a can of spinach, scramble eggs into it, and people ask her where she got it because they've grown so far away from their cultural ways that they don't know what that is anymore. But, and then my grandma really expressed time. She hasn't been out to hunt because she was going to school and she was working. She didn't have the time to go out and take the time to not only gather them, but clean them, cut them up, and serve them. And then Walmart, again, is probably the biggest factor of us losing who we are. And one of the quotes that John really says at the bottom, we lose all of that, the clean water for purification. Not because of us, but the way the industries now think we have to have oil to keep our lights on and the automobiles running. And that's the biggest fight that's going on right now. Who are we? We can't live without a cell phone. We can't live without the technology that we have. But those things require oil. How do we respect the land and the water if the things that we use every day are the things creating those problems? And then this ties up, summarizes the whole thing. And the Western idea worldview, land is a resource for capital, limiting access to those that can pay for access. And then in one of the books that I read through this process, The Reservoir Renewal, outlines a resource-based approach versus a relationship-based approach to viewing environmental governance. And then now is just the final slide, implications. Well, I feel like I could have done a lot more with this research. I could have talked to a lot more people and gathered a lot more insight, but I was stretched for time. That was really hard for me because when you do these things, you have to do it the right way. You have to really be open to them. You have to sit there and listen. You can't just, set a time slot and hope that you get everything that you need in that short amount of time. And that goes in with availability and then openness. Some of them didn't want to be recorded because you see in your textbooks the misconceptions of Native people, because people will record them and put it in their own words. They won't take it how it's supposed to be. And then something that I would like to do in the future like this is do it across generations. See the change that maybe has happened. Start with the elders, then go to, like the mid young adults or middle-aged adults, and then to the children. What do they know? What do they see in the world? And also across different tribes. Let's just focus on Cherokee due to time, but I think it would be interesting to see what everybody else thinks about this, see how they do it, because I imagine that the themes would be similar, but also very different. So now I want to open the floor for